Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now here's a message from Pastor Luke Cobray.
I'm going to get down on my knees. I'm going to go before the Lord in prayer. If you're able to stand, would you join me and let's stand together and prepare our hearts to go before the Lord tonight. So Lord, we just come before you. Father, we're just grateful for the opportunity to be here in the house of God. Lord, we're just so thankful that we get to come and to worship you, Lord, without fear of persecution. Lord, without wondering or worrying about what goes on. But Lord, we thank you that we can come and we can leave all the weight, all of the worries, all of our thoughts and all of our plans aside for this short moment. And we can focus our eyes and our attention on you. Lord, we don't come to hear from a man or to hear from a woman. Lord, we don't come to hear from church tradition or for ritual sake. Lord, we come to hear from you. So Lord, we ask in the name of Jesus, whom we acknowledge as the leader of this house, that your Holy Spirit would be our teacher. Just as Jesus promised his disciples a helper or a counselor, Lord, we pray that your Holy Spirit would teach us, would guide us, would lead us in your word tonight, Lord, that we would grab a hold of your concepts that you would have us to hear tonight, Lord, and that we would take it, we would apply it, we would live it, we would remember it, and Lord, that we would bear much fruit for your kingdom. And Lord, we thank you for all that you've blessed us with. We ask that you bless all the churches across the Inland Empire and around the world that are preaching and hearing the gospel of Jesus Christ. Lord, we ask that you would bless them as you have blessed us. We don't ever think of ourselves as better than anybody else. So Lord, we ask that you bless churches like Harvest and The Grove. Lord, I ask that your hand would be upon Sandals and Water of Life, Ecclesia, The Way. Lord, Emmanuel Baptist, bless our Catholic brothers and sisters and all of our different denominational brothers and sisters, the Calvary Chapels around the area. Lord, we thank you that you would bless all of the churches, our brothers and sisters in Christ, as we work together to build your kingdom, Lord, for your glory. Lord, we thank you that to you be the glory and the honor. In Jesus' mighty name. And we all said,
amen.
Amen. Well, tonight is a exciting night. This is the night where I knew we were going to conclude on. It's got to be my favorite story of the Bible. Now, I've told you about my favorite character of the Bible. That's Peter. I've told you about the person that I can relate sometimes the most to. That's John. Today, I want to talk about or finish on my favorite story. And just like we did last week, if you're just joining us, this is part three of looking at a series where we look into or look at some of the characters of the Bible, specifically the New Testament, those who formulated and who helped shape the church as we know it today. And tonight, we're going to continue and conclude by looking at Paul, the apostle, or the apostle Paul. I want to just give you a little bit of an insight. Now, Paul is huge. It would be very difficult to cover the life of Paul in 30 minutes. Paul is single-handedly, without argument, without question, aside from Jesus Christ, the most important figure within the history of the church. And the writings of this man, the apostle Paul, are read every day, each and every day, more around the world than all of the books combined. This is a man who accounts for 2/3 of the New Testament, his writings. This is a man who accounts for what we would call the doctrine of systematic theology. What is that? Just what we believe in our day and age now, what we know and what we understand about grace, faith, and salvation. This is a man who literally shaped the history of the church. And every service we read the writings of this man. So we can't simply cover just the life of Paul. And you'll see that a great portion of this actually happens before we even know about or see about this man, Paul. Today I want to focus not so much on the life of Paul, but rather on how God used Paul to fulfill his plan. Like last week when we talked about John, I want to give you right off the front where we're going so that there's no surprises, because ultimately the message tonight is of no surprise. It's something that somebody's told you somewhere before in your life, and sometimes you just need to hear it again. The message or the motivation, the big picture for tonight is simply this. God has a plan. That's it. God has a plan. You know, I remember I grew up in the 80s, and I was a kid, and I was one of those kids that loved Legos and to build things and to put things together. I was always in the garage taking things apart and trying to figure out how to make things and whatever it could be. I spent all of my time outside, and as a kid, I grew up in the era of the A-Team. Now, all right, Liam Neeson and the other guys, they did a good job in that movie that was on, you know, a couple of years ago, but I'm talking about the original A-Team, you know what I mean? Mr. T, right? And I remember that it was the Colonel, would always say, you know, because the A-team, they was always up against the wall. They were always cornered against some horrible villain or some drug cartel, and they were always up against the wall, cornered into some warehouse, and all they had was like a van and a bulldozer and a propane torch, and somehow they put it all together, and they'd make this amazing thing. And if you always remember at the end of the movie or at the end of the series or at the end of the show, the colonel would always say, boy, I love it when a plan comes, you see all my A-team fans, you know what I'm talking about. I love it when a plan comes together. I'll tell you from, I think it was 1983 to 1987, the A-team was always on. It was just like the highlight of afternoon television and prime time, and it was just so good. But you know, today we're going to talk about a story. We're going to look at the story of God's plan by using this man, Paul. And this is a story that the A-team can't come close to. This is a drama for the ladies, maybe, where Days of Our Lives, or As the World Turns, or whatever else it is on TV, this is one of those dramas that soap operas will never touch. Because God has a plan, and God uses men to fulfill His will and His plan. And today we're going to look at the life and how God used Paul. I'll use the name Saul interchangeably because as we see him in the beginning, his name is Saul. We'll talk about why did he change his name. We'll talk about that tonight. But I want to take you to Romans in the 8th chapter. Romans in the 8th chapter, verse number 28, familiar verse. This is really the message in the heart of where we're going tonight, looking at the Apostle Paul. Romans in the 8th chapter, verse number 28 says, and we know that all things work together for good to those who love God, to those who are called according to His purpose. If anybody has the right to write, get that? The right, R-I-G-H-T, to W-R-I. If anybody has the right to write that statement, it's Paul. We're going to look at this statement of God's plan. Now, God has a plan. And as it's no secret what we've talked about, if God can use Peter, what can He do with you? If God can use John, if you remember, if you didn't listen, you can. If you weren't here last week or if it's your first time, you can go back online and check it out that way. You can grab the CD after service. If it's your first time, take that thing over, then grab last week's or whatever. If God can use John, what can God do with you? Today as we conclude, if God can use Paul, what can God do with you? If you've got your Bibles, go with me to the book of Acts. I want to take you all the way back to the beginning, and we're going to go on a journey to see how God has a plan. And I'll take it one step further by saying, God has a plan for you. Amen. Take it all the way back to the very beginning, and we arrive here on the hills of Judea. Jesus is with His disciples, some probably about 37 days, I imagine, after He was risen from the dead. It says 37 to 40 days after He rose from the dead, after being crucified, He spent the past month with His disciples. And now He's standing there with them, and He's about to ascend, He's about to leave. He's about to find Himself now in His heavenly position, in His heavenly place, His rightful position on the right hand of God. And in Acts, the first chapter, He begins to instruct the disciples, His followers, about the things that He's taught them. And very familiar verse, but what I would call the very beginning of church history is Acts chapter 1, verse number 8. Jesus says, you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you. And you shall be witnesses to me in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. And if you know the story, you know that Jesus ascends to the heavens and an angel comes and says, why are you looking to the sky? To where Jesus went, He'll come the same way. And the Bible tells us that the disciples and the apostles, they're interchangeable at this point. Apostle simply means sent one or somebody who was sent. So the disciples wait in what we would call the upper room where they were waiting for the Pentecost. And they were waiting there as Jesus told them to wait till the Holy Spirit comes upon them. So we know the story that they waited in that upper room for 10 days, 120 people. Think about that for a moment. Just 120 people in the upper room. Now, the upper room was not like an auditorium, okay? Like the children's ministry class. The upper room was the upper room of somebody's house. right? Now, this was probably somebody who was well off. Maybe they had a big house. They had, you know, a big meeting place. But can you imagine 10 days of waiting in a room with 120 people, right? We're Americans. We have this thing that most of the world has no concept of called personal space. You know what I'm talking about? All you have to know what personal space is go to an amusement park and you'll see the violation of that when you wait in line, when somebody from another country presses against you, right? I've had one of our young adults teams, they went to Japan and they were talking about the train in Japan, you know, the metro rail, and how they had people literally that were just there to push you in and shove as many people in the train, and faces are smashed against the glass. So I kind of just imagine this. The Bible says that they were all with one accord for 10 days in this upper room, waiting, following the instructions of Jesus. And you know the story, the Holy Spirit comes upon them like a sound of a mighty rushing wind. They all appeared with tongues of fire above their heads, and they all began to speak in other languages. They went out into the streets, and because it was Pentecost, because it was a great time of pilgrimage, Jerusalem had swollen. The population of Jerusalem swells during this time because people from all over the world make a pilgrimage for Pentecost as well as for the Passover. So the population is all over. Everybody from all over the world is there in Jerusalem. And there they go out into the streets under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, and they begin to speak in other languages, the languages of the people who are there. Just imagine all the different villages and all the different tribes and all the different people, the Bible says, who were devout Jews or devout men of God. So they were there to seek after God, and all of a sudden they see this Judean or this Galilean, and they're speaking a language afar off, and they say, man, these guys are drunk and they must be crazy. And then you know the story, we talked about it a couple of weeks ago. Peter jumps up and he delivers his sermon, and the Bible says thousands came to the church that day. If you go back to Acts chapter 1, verse number 8, Jesus tells his disciples something. You will be witnesses to me in Jerusalem and in Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. So often we read that statement and we think, well, Jesus kind of laid out the order of which it will go. It'll be Jerusalem first, and then it'll be Judea, and then it'll be Samaria, and then it'll be the ends of the earth. But can I tell you something? God's plan wasn't Jerusalem and then Judea and then Samaria and then the world. God's plan, God's desire here was it was to be Jerusalem and also Judea, or the surrounding area, and also Samaria, the people who are outcast, and also the entire world. You see, if you remember when Jesus was there in John the 4th chapter talking to the woman at the well, he said there will be a time when you no longer worship on this mountain, you no longer worship in Jerusalem, but the true followers of God will worship in spirit and truth. That time had come. Jesus said now the message of the cross, the message of the Messiah was no longer just for the Jew. Now it was for the entire world. And in one moment, boom, the Holy Spirit comes upon the faithful followers because they were in one accord. And the gospel is preached to devout men and women of God, those who had came to Jerusalem to seek after God. And so, as you can imagine, when they go home, they begin to tell the story of, well, there was this guy, Peter, and he got up and he talked and he taught about Jesus. And the world began to change, but something didn't quite happen. You see, I want to just set the story for where we're at, because what's about to happen is persecution comes to the church. How many of you guys have a Bible? Just raise your hand or hold it. All right. If you have a Bible, or maybe you're reading it on, I saw some glowing screens. If you're reading it on a tablet or on your phone, I just want you to take a look at it for a moment. And then just close it. Because this is a time, now you can open it back up if you want later on. We'll continue. I'm not telling you not, you know. But I want you to understand, this is a time in church. They didn't have the Bible. They didn't have Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. They didn't have Romans and Acts. They didn't have Ephesians. They didn't have Philippians and Colossians and 1 and 2 Corinthians. They didn't have 1 and 2 Timothy. They didn't have 1 and 2 Peter. They didn't have 1, 2, and 3 John. They didn't have Jude. They didn't have Revelation. They didn't have James. They didn't have the Bible. They didn't even have the ability to read, most people. All they had was the words of men like Peter, James, and John and the apostles who walked with Jesus, who said, let me tell you about a man that changed my life. They didn't understand about grace. Oh, what? They didn't know about faith. They barely understood salvation. You know, the doctrine of Christianity at the time of Peter was threefold. You know what it was? Jesus Christ came, Jesus Christ died and rose again, and Jesus Christ was coming back. That was Christianity at its base. And over that simple belief, no Bible, no Word of God, no understanding, no being able to search it for themselves unless you were the Bereans and you were educated, they risked their lives and died over the testimonies, the stories of men who followed after this guy, Jesus, who died on a cross, who rose on the third day, who spent 40 days with his disciples teaching them after he rose, and who's now in heaven with God. That's all they had, but yet the church grew. And so here we find ourselves in this position where the church begins to grow. And if you remember, Jesus said to his disciples, you'll be witnesses, not to Jerusalem, and then. He said, you'll be witnesses to the whole world. But the Bible tells us in the book of Acts, as the church began to grow, people spread and the word of God spread. But the disciples hung out in Jerusalem. They stayed. They were there in Solomon's portico. Every day they would preach the word of God and they'd get arrested. They'd go to jail. They'd go before the council. They'd get miraculously released. Then they'd go back to the portico and get arrested. And over and over. And they stayed in Jerusalem. The Bible says that they begin to sell their possessions and lay them at the apostles' feet. And they begin to share with each other this communal church in Jerusalem. But if you remember the words of Jesus, he said that my church, the mission is not just for Jerusalem. It's not just for Jerusalem and Judea or Jerusalem, Judea and Samaria. It's for all the world. But yet only ones that were going out at this time were the people on Pentecost who had heard and were going home. Somehow the church had to grow outside of Jerusalem because Jerusalem had a fate headed for it some 30 years later to be destroyed completely by Rome, which means the church had to move outside of Jerusalem in order for the message to continue. How do you move the church outside of Jerusalem? Well, it's very simple. In this time, there was basically three types of people who believed in Jesus. There were Jews. The Jews were like, who we'll talk about, Paul or Peter, who were born in Judea or in what we would know as modern day Israel. You could call them, for lack of a better term, purebreds, okay? Then there was what we would call a Hellenist or a Greek Jew, which means these were Jews like the product of like Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, who were taken away by the captivity, were raised under different cultures, the Grecian way, so they often spoke Greek, but they were called Hellenist Jews. They still held to their Jewish ways, but they were raised Greek. And the third was a proselyte or a God-fearer, somebody who was not in the Jewish bloodline, but who accepted and converted into the Jewish belief. And in this, the message was spread to these people, to the Jewish, to the Hellenists, and to the proselytes. And as the church in Jerusalem began to grow, the Jews and the Hellenists began to argue because they were feeling like, you know, you Jews, you purebreds, you're really not giving the attention to us Greek Jews. So the apostle said, man, we can't continue to do this on our own. Let's bring up some young men and let them do the job and take care of the widows and to serve the ministry needs. And so they chose seven Hellenist men in Acts, the seventh chapter. One of these men his name is Stephen. Oh, and Stephen was a young, fiery guy. Oh, you couldn't shut him up. Just like most of these other guys, you'll see another guy, his name was Philip. You couldn't shut them up. They were just preachers. They were excited. They didn't have a Bible. They just had the Word of God from somebody else, but they preached the gospel of Jesus Christ. And this young man, Stephen, he rises up and he's a preacher. He's out there preaching and he finds himself before the Jewish high council called the Sanhedrin. And he has to answer for his message that he's been preaching. And I'll tell you what, Stephen, he does something. He opens up his mouth. You ever just felt like you just wanted to lay into somebody and just tell them like it is? You ever been there before? I'll tell you, I'm there like every day. Stephen just lets him have it, man. He starts with Abraham and works his way through. I mean, he goes through the Old Testament, teaches them. And I mean, these guys are up there. Just imagine like the Supreme Court and the justices behind their big, desk, just glaring their teeth at this guy. And then Stephen says, and the Bible tells us in Acts 7 chapter, Stephen says, the Bible tells us that the Holy Spirit came upon him. And he gazed into heaven and he saw the glory of God. And he saw Jesus standing at the right hand of God. And Stephen says in verse number 56, he said, "Look, I see the heavens and the Son of Man standing at the right hand of God." Oh, I'll tell you what. This just upset the Jewish council like you couldn't believe. The Bible says they cried with a loud voice and they covered their ears and they ran and they rushed Stephen, threw him outside of the door, and they took him out to the city limits, and there they stoned Stephen because they could not handle the message of Jesus and the cross. Stephen is huge in church history because Stephen was known as the first Christian martyr, the first person to die recorded in the Bible for the name of Jesus Christ. Think about that. No Bible, no Matthew, no Mark, no Luke, no John, no writings of Paul. No dispensation of grace, no open word to the whole, the testimony of men who walked with Jesus. And this man gave his life for Jesus. But something amazing happens. They cast him out of the city and they stoned him. And the witnesses laid down their clothes at the feet of a young man named Saul. This is the very first time in the Bible we see who you and I later know as Paul the Apostle. This young man, Saul, probably somewhere in his 20s, was there at the stoning of the first martyr, the very first person to die for Jesus. And there I can just imagine is the young Saul of Tarsus, arms crossed, in disapproval of what Stephen said. And as they lay their clothes down so as not to soil them when they enact the process of killing Stephen, they lay them down at no one else's feet but Saul. The very first time we see this story, and this man is at the death of the first martyr. Now, Acts chapter 8 tells us, verse number 1, that Saul had consented to his death. Saul had agreed. Saul was in agreement with the leadership of the church, or of the Jews, to stone, to kill Stephen for what he said. Consenting to that death, and at that time, a great persecution arose against the church, which it was at Jerusalem. Do you remember Jesus' words in Acts chapter 1, verse number 8? "You shall be witnesses to me," where? Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and all the world. So he says a great persecution arose to the church was where? At Jerusalem. How do we get the church to go beyond Jerusalem? This young man named Saul becomes the catalyst for the growth of the church by persecuting them, by going to their homes and dragging anybody who professed Jesus as Messiah out of their homes. Husbands away from wives, and wives away from husbands, and children away from mothers and fathers. And here at the hands of this young man, Saul, they would drag you away from your family and lock you up in prison so that you would share the fate of Stephen eventually, committing blasphemy against God, a crime to the Jews punishable by death. Here, the catalyst is this young man, Saul. Saul was the perfect character in this story. That's why I say Days of Our Lives, the A-Team, any great drama has nothing on this story. Why? Because you couldn't pick a more perfect person. Why? Because Paul explains it in the book of Philippians. He says, man, I've got the reason of all the Jews to boast. He says, I was a Hebrew of Hebrews. I was born of the tribe of Benjamin, the prestigious tribe. I was circumcised on the eighth day, raised a Pharisee, or the aristocracy of Judaism. I was trained, he tells us, under one of the most famous rabbis or teachers of the day, a man named Gamaliel, who taught him. Saul was born through his family a Roman citizen, which gave him rights to freely travel anywhere within the modern world of the day. Saul spoke Greek and Hebrew. Saul had an open invitation to any synagogue. He had an open letter of approval from the high priest to follow after the Christians and hunt them. Saul was the character of characters. And yet, here's this young man, Saul, becoming the catalyst to church growth by forcing them out of their comfort zone through persecution. Pastor Deborah taught a message a couple of weeks ago about stirring the nest and how an eagle stirs her nest to get the youngins out. Hey, man, you can't be living in my house forever. Some of the parents are like, man, maybe I need to do that with my young adult. Yes! Praise God. And here God begins to stir the nest of the church through persecution. And look what it says, verse number 2. And devout men carried Stephen to his burial and made great lamentation over him. Verse number 3 says to us, as for Saul, he made havoc on the church, entering every house and dragging off men and women, committing them to prison. Committing them to prison. So here Saul encourages and drives the church away. Go back to verse number 1. At the great time, there was a persecution that rose against the church, which was at Jerusalem. Thank you, that's what I was looking for. Part B, and they scattered throughout the regions of Judea and Samaria? Wait a minute. Didn't Jesus in Acts chapter 1 say that you would be witnesses of me in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and all the world? But in verse number 1, in the first part of that, it says the church was in Jerusalem. So how do you get Jerusalem into the world? Through a young man named Saul who wreaked havoc on the church, who drove them to Judea and Samaria and all the world. All of a sudden, God uses this young terrorist to the church to cause it to grow. What that says to you and I? Is in your darkest area of your life, in the darkest moment that you're going through, let me tell you something. God's not done. The story's not over. Stephen was just killed. People are being dragged out of their homes. The church seems like it's hopeless. What are we going to do? This young guy, Saul, has got the letters from the high priest. Where do we go from here? Let's go to Judea. Let's go to Samaria. Let's go to all the world. Let's go up to Antioch and let's go to the regions of Rome. And when we do, we'll be like Stephen because we can't shut up.
Yeah, come on.
And Philip tells us, the Bible tells us that Philip himself, one of the 7 Greeks that they chose, he went to Samaria. He started preaching about Jesus. Samaria experiences revival. There, the first planted church outside of Jerusalem is recorded in the Bible. Peter and John make their way up to witness what is going on, and they are amazed that Jesus Christ is taking Samaria by storm. And it all comes because this young man who is zealous, a terrorist, was driving the church out of their comfort zone. So the story goes on that Paul gets a letter from the high priest, the chief priests, that says you can go all the way up to Damascus on your hunt for Christians. Saul of Tarsus was on a hunt for Christians to find anybody who professed Jesus as Messiah, to pull them out of their house, to bind them up in chains, and to pull them back to Jerusalem so that they would share Stephen's fate. And so the story goes that Saul of Tarsus finds himself on the road to Damascus to seek and to hunt after Christians. And it's on this road that the entire course of history is changed forever. The world on this road during this season for this young man's life will never be the same again. Because in Acts, in the 9th chapter, the Bible tells us, as he journeyed, speaking of Saul of Tarsus, he came near Damascus, and suddenly a light shone around him from heaven. And then he fell to the ground and he heard a voice saying to him,
Saul.
You like that?
Why are you persecuting me?
Just imagine a light that casts no shadow, a blinding light that knocks him off his horse. The Bible tells us that Saul says everybody around saw the light. And here, the voice of no one else but Jesus Christ comes to this man, Saul of Tarsus. Says, why are you persecuting me? Saul says, who are you, Lord? Jesus responds, I am Jesus whom you are persecuting. Can you imagine the penny dropping in Saul's life right there? You ever wonder sometimes when you make a decision, did I make the right decision? Can you imagine now thinking back to what happened with Stephen? What happened back to the hunts? All the different people that Paul ripped out of their homes and from their families. And now all of a sudden he realizes that all along he was going against God. Jesus says, it's hard for you to kick against the goads, to pet the cat backwards, to go upstream. Verse number 6. So he trembled, Paul trembling and astonished, says, Lord, what do you want me to do? The moment history changed forever. The moment recorded as Saul of Tarsus' conversion from being a terrorist to being a disciple and an apostle of Jesus Christ. And Jesus says to Paul, to Saul, go into the city, Damascus, and it will be told what you must do. And the Bible tells us that they took Paul, or Saul, they led him by hand because he was blinded by the light and he had scales over his eyes. And at that time, God spoke to a man on a city street called Straight Street. The man by the name of Ananias. And Ananias, God says to him, Jesus says, Ananias, there's a man coming to you by the name of Saul of Tarsus. I want you to lay hands on him. Ananias says, wait a minute. I know that name. I know that name. That is the guy that is ripping everybody out of their house and killing them. You want me to go seek him out and pray for him? Remember how we went back to Acts chapter 1, verse number 8? Let's go back a little bit further. You remember when Jesus told his disciples, bless those who persecute you? Here it is. And Jesus tells Ananias, go, for he is a chosen vessel of mine to bear my name before Gentiles, kings, and the children of Israel. God says to Ananias, Ananias, this guy's a part of my plan. And I love it when a plan comes together. So as the story goes on, Ananias, they meet. Ananias lays hands on Paul's, and Paul, and the scales are lifted from his eyes. And Saul of Tarsus begins immediately to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ in Damascus. I mean, people are like, wait a minute, isn't this Saul? The Bible tells us in Saul's story that Saul is so zealous, he goes to Jerusalem. He wants to tell Peter, James, and Paul, hey, we're friends now. Peter, James, and Paul, Peter, James, and John, they're kind of like, wait a minute, no. We saw what you did to Stephen. This is a trap. You're trying to reverse psychology. No. So Paul is rejected at the church. This begins in Paul's life, what we call the dark era or the dark ages of Paul's life. Historians say anywhere between 7 and 14 years. Paul says it was 14 years in his life from his encounter with Jesus to his return. 14 years. The book of Acts in a couple of chapters skips over. We don't know much about that. But you know what's amazing is that in 14 years, Saul goes back to his home. He hears from the word of God. He's very relatively unknown. People forget about this guy. Who is this Saul of Tarsus? And the world goes on. You know, that says that sometimes God has a plan. But you know, sometimes I'll tell you in my own life, it feels like God forgot the plan. You ever been there before? God, I thought you had a plan. God, I thought this was supposed to happen. Did you forget? Did something happen? Where did we miss the road? Imagine Saul of Tarsus for 14 years. God, you said, I'm going to be a vessel. to kings, to the world. It's been 14 years. And then all of a sudden the Bible picks up in the book of Acts, chapter 11. A man of great encouragement, Barnabas, seeks for Saul of Tarsus. Barnabas finds Saul, and he brings him back to Antioch. And so for a whole year, Barnabas and Saul joined the assembly with the church, and they taught many people. And the disciples were first called Christians in Antioch. So here now all of a sudden, 14 years later, Saul is with this man, Barnabas, the son of encouragement. In the church of Antioch, the Bible tells us, or historians tell us, excuse me, that Antioch, the church of Antioch, was hundreds of thousands of people. Talk about mega church. No Bible, no big screen projectors, no lights, no microphones, no fog, just the Word of God. From people who walked with Jesus, or from people who heard from people who walked with Jesus. And here the church grew in Antioch. And the Bible tells us that Barnabas took a man named Saul with him on a journey to what we would know as Turkey. And Barnabas and Saul went on this journey. And there on this journey, the Bible tells us is the rise of who we know as Paul the Apostle. There, Saul changes his name to Paul. Why did Paul have change his name? Well, because Paul was a Roman citizen, Paul would have had a Roman name. His Benjamin name was Saul, after the first and great king of his fellow tribe of Benjamin. Saul, the great king who was a head taller than everybody else. It was a proud name. Everybody wanted to name their son Saul. Now, in his Roman name, to go throughout his Roman country, his Greek name was more than likely Paul. And the Bible begins to make this transition that it was Barnabas and Saul, Barnabas and Saul, Barnabas and Saul, Barnabas and Saul, Paul and Barnabas. Paul and Barnabas. Paul and his company. Paul and his travelers. The Bible is very distinct when they wrote, you know, I'm not sure if you know this, but it's not proper grammar to say, me and so-and-so went somewhere. Did you know that? You're not supposed to say it like that? You know, like, let's say, me and Ken. Me and Ken went to the movies. You're not supposed to say it like that. You're supposed to say, Ken and I went to the movies, right? Because whoever's second is inferior. So it started out as Barnabas, the leader, and Saul, the number two, and somehow something happened. And Paul becomes the superior. Because now Paul has this dispensation of grace, of faith, of salvation. He's heard from Jesus Christ as he talks about his thorn in the flesh, that Jesus Christ himself came to him and said, my grace is sufficient for you. And so Paul has spent this time. He says, whether I was in person or not, I don't know. I knew a man and he taught me. I spent time with Jesus Christ and he taught me. The theology that the church would later found the entire foundation of Christianity, here is this man that rises up. I mean, chew on that for a minute. God took this young terrorist, Saul of Tarsus, and he used him as a vessel for the church to grow by persecuting the church so that they would leave Jerusalem and fulfill Acts chapter 1, verse number 8, by going to Judea, Samaria, and all the world. And then he took that terrorist, knocked him off his horse, blinded him, converted him, gave him the dispensation of grace, faith, and salvation, and brought him back 14 years later to teach the people he persecuted what Christianity really is all about. God has a plan. And when it seems like the crap has hit the fan, God has a plan for you. God has a plan for me. Now, Jesus told his disciples, Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and all the world. Jesus knew what was coming. He knew about the fall of Jerusalem. And so here, this man on his second journey with his friend Barnabas, they try to go to Asia. He says, the Holy Spirit didn't permit us. We tried to go here and the Holy Spirit wouldn't let us. We tried to go here and we were resisted by the Spirit of God. Paul was a man who followed God's lead. If the whole thing that you get tonight is, if anything else, is that God has a plan. And if God has a plan, we can learn from Paul by saying, follow God's lead. It may not happen in the time frame you want, but think of Paul's 14 years. It may not look how you want. Paul followed God's lead, sometimes leading to persecution and suffering, sometimes leading to great accomplishments. And in the case here, on his second missionary journey, the Bible says that Paul had a dream, a vision of a Macedonian man that bid them, that beckoned them, that pleaded with them, saying, come to Macedonia and help us. Where's Macedonia? Greeks. Okay? Greece. All right? Anybody in my big fat Greek wedding, right? Greek. Now after he had seen the vision, immediately we sought to go to Macedonia. Luke was with him. He said, concluding that the Lord had called us to preach the gospel to him. God had a plan. You know what happens? Paul gets on a boat, hightails it to Macedonia. He finds himself in a city called Philippi. There in a city called Philippi on a Sabbath Saturday, they're out walking by the river, and there's a lady out there who sells purple. Her name is Lydia, and she's doing her laundry. Paul, the apostle, begins to talk about this man, Jesus Christ, who died on the cross, who rose from the dead, who's coming back again, who saved mankind. And the Bible tells us that Lydia's heart was open and she received Jesus, her and her family, and they accepted Paul. And here we see in the book of Acts in the 16th chapter, the very first convert recorded in the Bible on the continent of Europe. Why is that so big? Because in 70 AD, Jerusalem was obliterated by Rome. Nothing was left standing. No church in Jerusalem was left open. That's why when you go to Israel today, there's only one part of the original walls of Jerusalem left, and that's what they call the Wailing Wall. It was obliterated by Rome, which means the church had to move from Jerusalem to Europe. And as the church moved from Jerusalem after the obliteration of Jerusalem to Antioch, and eventually through the advent of Islam to Rome, Europe becomes the center of Christianity, where the entire world is taught about Jesus Christ through Johann Gutenberg's printing press invention, the Bible. Where America is populated through missionary efforts from the South and from the freedom of persecution to the North. And now you and I are here today because God had a plan for a young terrorist to meet a lady named Lydia, to start a church in the continent of Europe, to found the capital of a church that would exist for thousands of years, that would meet and gather through councils to solidify the word of God, that would be proven over and over and over and over again, so that thousands and thousands and thousands and thousands of years later, you and I can look down at our laps and read the Bible, the words of this man, Paul. Because God has a plan. Jeremiah 29:11. God says, for I know the thoughts I have for you, says the Lord. Thoughts of peace and not evil, to give you a future and a hope. He goes on, thoughts to restore you. Thoughts to draw you in, a plan to bring you out of captivity, the captivity not just of Israel to Babylon, but the captivity of humanity to sin. As the one man who teaches us the dispensation of grace, as we are no longer slaves of sin, but now under grace. God has a plan. God had a plan for his church. Church, God has a plan for you. And if anything else tonight, as we finish the series of looking at the stories of the Bible and the characters of the Bible, if God can use a man like Peter, who constantly put his foot in his mouth, who denied Jesus 3 times, if God can use a man like John, who had a little bit of pride, a little bit of arrogance, a little bit of conceit, if God can use a man like Paul, who was a terrorist to his followers, what can God do with you?
Yes, amen, amen, amen.
What can God do with you? there is a hope for you today. That God has a plan for you. And that God has a desire for you. And God can use you. The question as you leave tonight, are you willing to be used by God? Because God can use you if you are. Did you guys get something out of that tonight? Well, hey, before we leave today, I just want to take a quick moment. And I just want to exhort those of you who are in this place. Give you the opportunity, first and foremost, to just tell you, listen, God loves you so much that He did everything He could to ensure you spend eternity in heaven with Him. Like Stephen said, full of the Holy Spirit, I see Jesus there at the right hand of God, standing in the presence of God. His desire is for you to share in that. To spend an eternity with God. So the question I want to ask is, well, what happens when you die? Whether it be tonight, tomorrow, 30 years from now. What happens when you wake up your eyes or you open your eyes? The Bible is very clear that we have two options. You're not going to come back as a frog or a log or anything like that. You've got two options, heaven or hell. Where are you going to spend eternity? I don't say that to scare you. I don't say that to shock you. I say that to ask you to look into your heart and to look into your life and to be honest with yourself. Because you don't do yourself any favors by making it better than it is. By trying to pat it or trying to make it sound more than what it is. Look into your heart and look into your life and answer the question honestly within your own heart. Because how you answer that question says a lot on your position with God. Did you know that nowhere in the Word of God does it say that you can hope, think, want, wish, or desire yourself into heaven? Man, if I live my life and I want to go to heaven bad enough that eventually I'll find myself there and I'll get there in heaven. Did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that? Nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you were raised in church, because you were baptized or christened as a baby, because your godparents made an oath or swore for you on your behalf, or because you went to Sunday school or catechism classes. Nowhere in the Bible does it say that because your parents told you you were a Christian, or because you went to church on Christmas and on Easter all your life, that you're going to get to heaven. Did you know that nowhere in the Word of God will you find that? Nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you've given yourself the title of Christian that you're going to get yourself in heaven. We like to give ourselves labels in America. We call ourselves all sorts of things to fit into a mold or a genre or whatever it might be. Did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you've given yourself a label of Christian, that means that you're going to get into heaven? Nowhere in the Word of God do you see. I remember I was talking to a friend of mine. And he said, well, you know, I'm not a Buddhist or a Hindu or a Muslim or anything like that. I always just thought that that meant I was a Christian. Did you know that nowhere in the Word of God will you find that because you're not Buddhist, Hindu, Muslim, or other some type of world religion, that must mean by a system of classification or defaults that you're a Christian and therefore on your way to heaven? You'll never find that in the Word of God. Why? Because it's not there. You see, you can't get to heaven based on how good you are. A lot of people, I had a family member once tell me, man, I got to live the good life because I don't want to spend my life. They were camping in the desert and they said, I don't want to, if hell's like that, I got to live the good life. Did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you're a good person, because you give to charitable organizations, you give some of your tax return to help somebody else out, that you're going to get to heaven? Did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that? The Bible tells us our good deeds according to God's righteousness are like filthy rags. Nothing you and I could ever do would ever make us good enough to get into heaven. Why? Because you can't buy it, you can't earn it, you can't wish for it, you can't think it, you can't desire it, you can't label it in your life. The only thing you and I can do is accept it and live in it, and that is through Jesus Christ. See, the Bible tells us that the gift of God is eternal salvation through Jesus Christ. Can't do it your way or my way or some well-meaning church committee's way. The only way we can get to God's heaven is God's way, and that's His Son, Jesus. See, Jesus said these words. He said that He is the way, the truth, and the life. No one goes to the Father except through Him. So today I want to offer you God's way to ensure a life, not just of paradise when you die, but a life of fulfillment. Because Jesus said these words about you. Jesus said that I have come to give you life, that you might have it more abundantly. So how do we get there? You see, God's standard for heaven is perfection. But there was only one perfect person, and that's Jesus. Church is full of imperfect people like you and I. So how do we get there? The Bible says that we have all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. So today, let's do it God's way. And Jesus says this in John, the third chapter, speaking to a religious man. A man like Paul, who memorized the scripture, a man who gave to the poor, said all the right things, wore all the right clothes, did all the right things, had the approval of the leaders of his day. And Jesus says these words to this man. He says, you must be born again. What does that mean? Well, it's not what you think. It's not what Hollywood or sitcoms have made it out to be. Born again from the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible has always meant the same thing in the eyes and the heart of God. Here it is. It means that you've given God all of your heart. It means that you've given God all of your life. You see, it's an all or nothing relationship with Jesus Christ. Let me prove it to you. In the last book of the Bible, Jesus is speaking to his church. He writes seven letters to seven churches. In one of his churches, people like you and I, Jesus says these words. He says, I'm coming back and I'd rather find that you're hot or I'd rather find that you're cold, because if I find that you're lukewarm, he says, I will vomit you from my mouth. Shocking statement from the mouth of Jesus. And what he's saying is that lukewarm Christians are not real Christians at all. And they'll be rejected and ejected from the kingdom of God. What does it mean to be lukewarm? Lukewarm simply means, in terms of your relationship, let's define that. Let's clarify that. It simply means that with God, you've got your ups and you've got your downs. You've got your ins and you've got your outs. You're not wholehearted for God. You're not wholehearted against God. You're doing some of your own thing, doing some of the church thing. You got one foot in the church one day a week, and the other day of the week, you're doing your own thing. And if that's you, listen, let me love you enough, let me respect you enough, let me honor you enough today to tell you the truth, even if it hurts or rubs you the wrong way, that you're not going to make it. You can't get to heaven because you think so, because you want so, because you hope so. You can't get to heaven because you attend church. You can't get to heaven because you volunteer, you serve in the children's ministry. The only way you and I can get into God's heaven is God's way, and Jesus Christ paid that price on the cross. And in return, he wants all of our heart. He wants all of our lives. And today I want to offer to you the gift of eternal salvation. You see, like any gift, you have to choose to accept it or to reject it. God so respects you that he gave you a free will choice to make the decision on your own. Today you've heard the word. You heard the story of God's plan. You saw how God moved in the lives of men to accomplish his will. God's desire for you, his will for you, it's for you to find Jesus, to find fulfillment. And it starts by accepting the gift of salvation through Jesus Christ. Today, here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to do it this way. Jesus said, if you confess him before men, he'll confess you before his Father. He goes on, he says, but if you deny him, he'll deny you. So today, I'm going to do it like this. I'm going to count to three. I'll go one, two, and on the count of three, I'll go three. And I'll smack my hands together real loud. And when I do, if that's you, I want you to do something. I want you to do something for me real quick. I want you to pop your hand up. What you're doing by the raising of your hand when I pop my hands together is you're saying, Pastor Luke, today that's me. I want to make that decision. I want to give my heart. I want to give my life to Jesus Christ. You see, I'm a man. I'll see it. I'll acknowledge it. It's your choice. Listen, God's not a manipulator. He's not a conniver. He's not going to come and force his way in or make his way in. He did everything he could by giving Jesus Christ to die on a cross for our sin and our shame so that we can in turn receive Jesus and have life here on earth and life eternal with God. God's not in the business of condemning men to hell. Get that thought out of your mind. Jesus tells us in John, the third chapter, that he didn't send his son to condemn the world, but to save the world. God's in the business of redeeming men to heaven, and it starts by accepting the gift of Jesus Christ. So you have a choice. You can sit there and do nothing, or you can start by making the decision today. It's your call. God's not a manipulator. He's not a conniver, like I said. He's not in heaven with a 2x4. He's not there to beat you over the head with a 2x4 because you've made some dumb choices. He's not like a little kid on an anthill with a magnifying glass trying to burn you up. God wants you to succeed, and it starts by accepting Jesus Christ, his only begotten Son, as your Lord and as your Savior. It starts by making that decision today. I'm a man, I'll see it. You can put your hand right back down. Who should raise your hands if you've never given your heart, you've never given your life to Jesus? If that's you, in just a moment, get ready, pop your hand up. If you're not sure, maybe you did this as a child or in the youth group. Maybe you went to a Harvest Crusade and prayed that prayer once before. Or you did it on TV, but you never really followed through. Or maybe you're just not sure where you stand with God. Listen, don't walk out of this place today without making sure the decision is yours. Who should raise their hands if that's you in this place? If you've been living lukewarm, doing your own thing instead of God's thing. If you've been running from God instead of to God, if that's you, get ready. This is your moment. This is your time. Wherever you're at, when I count to three, I want you to pop your hand up. Be proud about it. Say, man, I might be embarrassed. I'm not going to embarrass you. But even if you were, wouldn't it be better to spend a moment of embarrassment than an eternity in hell because you couldn't go forward for God in a warm, welcome, and loving place? Listen, I don't want to give you the opportunity to hide. The world gives us so many opportunities to hide from God. It's time to stop hiding, and it's time to stand up for what you believe and to make that decision, and it starts today. Listen, whether you're in the front row, the back row, the family rooms, wherever you're at, watching online by television or around the campus hearing the sound of my voice, wherever you're at, if that's you in this place, this is your moment, this is your time. You've had doctors, dentists, and DMV appointments. Now it's a divine appointment between you and God. Don't let anything stop you from making the very best decision of your life tonight by accepting Jesus into your heart, into your life. It starts by making that decision. So I'm going to count to three in just a moment. If that's you, get ready. Pop your hand up. I'll see it. I'll acknowledge it. You can put it right back down, and we'll join together in changing destinies tonight. But it starts by making that decision. So I'm going to count to three wherever you're at. If that's you, get ready. This is your moment. This is your time. Today is the day of your salvation. Here we go. You ready? One, two, three. Let me see your hands in this place today. You say, I want to give my heart. I want to give my life to Jesus. I see you, my friend, right over there. Where are you at in this place today? I know that there's more than my one friend. I got you. You can put your hand down, my friend. Where are you at in this place? You say, man, I wonder if I should. You should. Come on. I'm not going to force you, not going to coerce you, not going to manipulate you, but I'll love you enough and respect you enough today to tell you the truth, to quit playing games with God. You say, man, Pastor, you're being real aggressive. You're being real assertive. You know what? Thank God somebody's aggressive and assertive enough to tell you the truth. See, hand over here. I got you, my friend, too. Where are you at in this place? You know it's you. The Bible says it's the goodness of God that draws men to repentance. It has nothing to do with me, nothing to do with the person next to you. It has everything to do with you and God. And it starts by making that decision. Two wise people. Anybody else in this place today? Say, man, I wonder if I should. You should. I'm going to wrap it up. Well, praise God for two wise people. That's awesome. Two is better than one. One is better than none. But let me tell you something. I know for a fact, by the Spirit of God, that there is more than two of you in here. But I will not force you. I will not manipulate you or coerce you. But what I will tell you is that you know you need to make this decision. And you're thinking in your heart and in your soul right now, in your mind, man, I missed it. I should have done this. But it's not too late. For those two of my friends that raised their hand, and for anybody else that you know you should be in this place, making that decision today. What we're going to do is we're all going to stand. When we do, I want you to grab your coat, your sweater, your purse, your Bible, friend, if you need a friend. I want you to get out of your seat, get out of your chair, and come into the aisle and come meet me right here. I want to shake your hands, and we're going to change destinies together right here, right now, you and I. So if you raise your hands, or you should raise your hands, come on and come meet me right here today. Let's change destinies together.
You, my King, would die for me. Amazing love, I know it's true.
Wherever you're at, if that's you, you come.
It's my joy to honor you.
I won't bite you, I promise.
Congratulations. Amazing love, how can it be?
Well, hey, praise God, you guys came. Awesome job. I want to share something fun with you. First of all, I want to tell you something. You know what? You're not going to a funeral. You're going to a birthday celebration. Okay, that means you can smile. It's good. Good stuff. You're making the best decision a human being could possibly make. I mean, that's pretty cool, right? You know what that says about you? It says that you're really smart. Good job. Here's what I want to do. I want to introduce a friend of mine to you. See this guy right over here waving at you in that really cool leather jacket? His name's Dr. Becker. We call him Dr. B, all right? Dr. B's going to do something with you. He's going to take you guys right over there. Nothing weird goes on, okay? I promise. You say, wait a minute, what happened? You said you were going to give Jesus your heart. You said you were going to give him your life. You don't do that by raising your hand. You do that by inviting him into your life to be the Lord and Savior of your life. What does that mean, Lord and Savior? We'll say it like this, the leader of your life. So he's going to lead you in a prayer. You're going to invite God through Jesus Christ to come into your heart, okay? He's going to give you some free information, real easy reading. Just says, hey, you walk out of this place, you say, man, I raised my hand in church. Now what do I do? We're going to help point you in the right direction. The third thing he's going to do is he's going to invite you to come back to hang out with us. We want you to get connected here. You heard the word of God. You responded. We want to connect you here at church with a friend, somebody that will sit with you right before church to buy you a cup of coffee or get you a soda, teach you some things about the word of God for just a couple of weeks to get you strong in the ways of God so you don't walk away or go back to the life that you're walking away from, but you go forward in everything that God has for you. So if you guys just turn to your left, my right, go right over there with Dr. Becker. Praise God.
Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow. You repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son and that you sent him for me and that he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven as well as upon the earth that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. If this message spoke to you, please share it with us. We'd love to hear from you. You can find more information at www.rockchurch.com.